When the guru and his disciples sat down to worship each evening, the ashram cat would get in the way and distract the worshipers. So the guru ordered that the cat be tied up during evening worship. After the guru died, the cat continued to be tied up for evening worship. And when the cat died, another cat was brought to the ashram so that it could be duly tied during worship. Centuries later, learned treatises were written by the guru's scholarly disciples on the liturgical significance of tying up a cat while evening worship is performed. What was practical became traditional. There is so much of tying up the cat in our own worship. Things that were practical become traditional. Of course, candles were necessary at worship before the advent of electric lights and gas lights, and now they are traditional. For who would need to put candles on the altar or beside an altar when there are perfectly good incandescent CFL, LED, and halogen lights in the ceilings or in the walls? The practical becomes traditional. And sometimes the traditional deeply enhances our worship. Do you recall, were you privy to all the brouhaha, all the kerfuffle that went on when right after the pews were covered, it was suggested that we not use real candles for Christmas Eve worship? Oh my goodness. Candlelight is evocative. And going to candlelight midnight mass is one of those things that draws lots of Easter and Christmas Christians or people from off the street being there with the candles. As we move through the instructed Eucharist today, see if you can detect those things that may have once been practical and are now traditional. Take note of the things that draw you more deeply into the sense of the holy, into the numinous. Morton Kelsey, an Episcopal priest who was also a Jungian analyst, wrote, "The church building in the Eastern Orthodox thinking is the vestibule of heaven." That's the way I remembered the quote, vestibule of heaven. When we come to church, we enter the vestibule of heaven. Now, I went a long way on that quote, but when I went and looked it up again, what he actually wrote was, "The vestibule of heaven because of artistic perfection." Now, St. Mary Magdalene does not look a thing like an Orthodox church, and yet there are countless members and visitors who have commented to me about how warm and inviting the building itself is, how warm and inviting this worship space is, how pleasing it is, what a pleasing place of worship. Let us bring our whole selves into the vestibule of heaven as we stand and sing our opening hymn.
Thank you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Almighty and merciful God, it is only by your gift that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading.
A reading from the book of Habakkuk. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not listen? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on the tablets, so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
You have issued your decrees. Second reading from Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We must always give thanks to God for you, brothers and sisters, as it is right, because your faith is growing abundantly, and the love of every one of you for one another is increasing. Therefore, we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God for your steadfastness and faith during all of your persecutions and the afflictions that you are enduring. To this end, we always pray for you, asking that your God will make you worthy of his call and will fulfill by his power every good resolve and work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
I am not satisfied, wrote Martin Luther, with those who despise music as fanatics do. For music is an endowment and a gift of God, not a gift of other persons. It also drives away the devil and makes people cheerful. One forgets all anger, unchasteness, pride, and other vices. I place music next to theology and give it the highest praise. Well, this was written by the gentleman who wrote the text to our opening hymn, that majestic resetting of Psalm 46. And we have it on good authority then that our music is part of our theology. Processions as well, gestures as well, movements as well, a part of our theology. They are practical and they can profess our theology. Processions are absolutely practical. You have to get people from one place to another place in the church. And it's also theological. Processions become prayer in motion. Here we are, the people of St. Mary Magdalene, on pilgrimage to the kingdom of God. Usually processions go with music. Think of a bridal procession. Think of the procession at the Easter Vigil when we all gather outside around the new fire, light the paschal candle, and then enter the darkened church singing the light of Christ. Thanks be to God. In some churches, parents and baptisms process to the font during the litany of the saints while that's being sung, or while other prayers or another litany for the baptizans is being sung. Each year, the first Sunday of Lent, we sing the Great Litany here, but in some churches, the Great Litany is sung while the entire congregation goes around and around and around the outside aisles of the church. Such a pilgrimage, such a parade, as Dr. Park likes to talk about it, God's parade. Practical, traditional, and theological. In truth, our pilgrimage to worship begins at home, as we prepare ourselves and our families, and we prepare our hearts to be transformed, to enter the vestibule of heaven. So we prepare at home, we process to the church, we enter the vestibule of heaven, and we pray that we may receive and respond to the gospel of good news with our reason, with our lips, and in our hearts.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I don't believe that Jesus expected a church or the church. Jesus preached the coming of the kingdom, the coming reign of God. However, the church is what we got. The church is a community of the new covenant, according to the Catechism in the Book of Common Prayer. When you hear the word ecclesiastical, do you think of churchy things? I think of churchy things when I hear ecclesiastical. I think about ecclesiastical potboilers. Those are great big books, novels, written by Susan Howitch and people like her that have priests who are doing church things and things that are not so churchy. Ecclesiastical. Actually, the word ekklesia is a Greek word that means called out. So that when in Colossians Christ is said to be the head of the body, the ekklesia in the Greek, the community of the people who are the called out ones, who are the believers of the risen Christ. So the ekklesia, the community of people called out as believers in Christ. The church is also a physical building, a sacred place where Christians have designated this is our place for corporate worship. As members of the Jewish community, the earliest disciples continued to pray and teach in the temple. But in 70 CE, the temple was destroyed by Rome. Because Christianity was illegal, early followers met in private homes, around a table, shared a meal. As the communities grew and spread, the communities designated a house and converted just an ordinary house into a place of worship. And during times of persecution, they met in the catacombs, those hollowed out places used for the burial of Jews. The earliest known complete church is a mid-third century Roman house that was converted into a gathering place for Christians in present-day Syria. It included a pool close to the entrance, which was likely used for baptism. Unlike the Jewish temple or the temples of the Greek and Roman gods, Christian churches are not seen as a dwelling place for a god, but as a central meeting place. Many churches today follow the basic design of a 4th-century civic basilica. A civic building, a rectangular building with a curved apse, a little curved piece at the back. That was where the throne went, the throne for the military governor or a magistrate. So in this ordinary rectangle building with the throne there, magistrate, business was going on, and the Christians just took over that shape. So rectangular building, curved apse in the back, throne for the bishop or for the priest. If you worship now at St. Mark's in Fort Lauderdale, you'll see that setup, rectangle building and a set of steps, and the clergy sit there where the magistrate would have sat in the Roman basilica. We can trace much of our church furnishings to the early church, and the early church furnishings to the secular buildings in the 4th century. The 4th century, because that's when Constantine won the battle and Christianity then became the accepted religion. What was practical became traditional. I think a question rises for us now. In the early days, was there something practical about reciting the creed every week? For you, is it so traditional that it's an ordinary thing, a waste of time? Or do you find that the weekly recitation of the creed secures you in your faith? Because I did not come from the Episcopal tradition. I came from a tradition that did not use creeds. When I was a new Episcopalian, I really appreciated the fact that each week I was able to recite my faith, a faith that I was learning anew as a young adult, and it was for me a great anchor, a foundation. So now, as we stand for the creed, consider, is this a practical thing for you? Is it a traditional thing for you? Is it a secure part of your faith?
Standing as you are able, I invite you to join us in renewing our faith by saying together the Nicene Creed, found on page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
I invite you to join in today's prayers of the people, which is found in your bulletin on page 6. Trusting in God's promises, let us pray for the church, the creation, the world, and all in need. We pray for the church assembled in your name, that it may practice faith in love, welcome the neighbor, and seek out the lost. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for the creation reflecting your goodness, that its trees and waters, cities and farms, offer shelter for all your creatures. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for the world redeemed in love, that leaders of nations, especially those to be elected, may use their power in humble service. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those in need, the outcast, the lonely, and the sick. May they trust always in your generous love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for this congregation, blessed by many talents and gifts, that our leaders may be wise stewards of resources and share abundantly with those in need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We remember the saints in every time and place. Hold us with them in your mercy until that day when all are welcomed at your endless feast. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Let us at this time offer up to Christ our own petitions. Let us offer up to Christ prayers for all those around us as we reflect on the week that's passed and the week ahead of us.
Ask your prayers for those who are homeless and for those who serve them. Ask your prayers for Wendell and Camille James. I ask your prayers for this parish as it entered stewardship season, that we may be able to share the gifts and bounties of our lives with God. I pray in thanksgiving for the bishop-elect of the Diocese of Indianapolis, who was just elected as the first African-American woman to be elected as a diocesan bishop in the Episcopal Church.
We pray in thanksgiving for God's many mercies upon us in the week just ended. We thank him for his many blessings. We remember all those who are ill from our own congregation. Pray for those facing surgery. We lift up to Christ all persons battling diseases. Help us all to rely on God's strength. We pray for all those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. We pray for God's care and compassion. We pray in thanksgiving for our choir, our choir director, and all the ministries of our church.
Almighty God, to whom we must account for all our powers and privileges, guide the people of the United States and our communities in the election of officials and representatives, that by faithful administration and wise laws, the rights of all may be protected and our nation may be enabled to fulfill your purposes through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Receive these prayers and those of our hearts, O God, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our hope and our Redeemer. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins, so our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Oh, is it okay to go upstairs?
Yeah.
Okay. You know, personas. Oh, still have the mic on.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Mary Magdalene Episcopal Church. If you are a guest or a visitor this morning, we'd love to get the opportunity to get to know you better. Do we have any guests or visitors who would like to introduce themselves? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Barbara from Charlotte, North Carolina. Welcome. It's a pleasure to have you here. That must have been difficult to leave Charlotte, North Carolina to come down here at this time of year. And we're glad that you're here. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Okay. Yes, yes. That's okay. Tell me your name.
Ariella.
Ariella, and where do you live?
I live in Miami.
In Miami. What school do you go to? You go to Miami Springs. What grade are you in?
Fifth
grade. We're glad that you're here with us this morning. Welcome. Good to have you with us. Hannah, I know that you have an announcement you would like to make with youth group. And I see you brought some help with you this time. Yeah. Enthusiasm.
Hi, my name is Hannah.
I'm Iron.
I'm Brielle.
Isabella.
Okay, and we're here to represent the Fountain of Youth Group. We are talking about the Ziploc and Gatorade packets to help make our kits for Haiti, and it is coming soon. We still need a lot of Ziploc bags, Gatorade packets. And we also have an opportunity for supporting us. On Saturday, November 12th at 6:00 p.m., we will be hosting an Italian night for your dining pleasure. Musical entertainment will be there, provided by our youths. Tickets are $15 for adults and $7 for kids under 12, and will be sold at the back of the church after the service. We thank you for helping us all throughout our different fundraisers. Thank you.
You're welcome. Great job, Hannah. Thank you. Welcome. I want to bring to your attention, there are a few announcements in your bulletin. One of them is the service that we will have for the commemoration of all faithful departed, All Souls Day, and we will have that this Wednesday, November 2nd at 7 p.m. here in the church. Then on the second page of your bulletin, there is a notice about the Grand Altrea that is taking place here at St. Mary Magdalene. For all of you who are in Curcio, or are curious about Curcio, and would be interested and like to participate, you're invited. The entire diocese will be here. All the members of the Curcio movement in the diocese will be here at St. Mary Magdalene, and we will have a function on Friday night and then also on Saturday, beginning at 11, registration at 11:30, will take us to 3:30, 4 o'clock or so on Saturday. So we hope that you'll be here. We'll have a lot of fun. There'll be singing. There'll be some people that will be giving talks. It's a great opportunity to see the people that you would normally see during Curcio, but you only get to see briefly as when we gather. So we hope that you'll come and participate with us and have some fun. We'll sing songs and enjoy fellowship with one another. Also remind you of the outreach fair that will be taking place next Sunday, between 9 and 12 o'clock in the parish hall. So if you are attending the 8 o'clock service or the 10:30 or the 12:30 service, you will be able to attend this. We hope that you will be there. Please take this home so you can see exactly what to expect. And last but not least, there's also an event for St. Lawrence Chapel, and that is outlined in the second to last page on your bulletin, and it gives a time and place for that. It takes place November 17th. It's Painting for a Purpose, and we hope that you will participate with us there. Do we have people doing healing prayers today? So that we will have healing prayers today. So after you take Holy Communion, there will be people stationed at the altar. If you would like for them to pray with you, they can. And when we do that, we deliver Holy Communion here at the foot of the altar steps here, so we invite you to do that, and the chalices will be on the ends, off to the sides, as we normally do. Is there anyone celebrating a birthday, a wedding anniversary, or traveling? I invite you to come forward for a blessing. Birthdays, wedding anniversaries, travelers. So birthdays here, wedding anniversaries in the middle, and travelers. Who's celebrating the birthday? How old?
Two.
2 years old. You are big for two. Excellent. Watch over your child, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful, and raise them up if they fall. and in our hearts, may the peace which passes all understanding abide with them all the days of their life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. You're welcome. Very good. Happy birthday. All right. How many anniversaries? Three anniversaries? Move down just a little bit. Move down just a little. We've got to squeeze everybody in. These right in here. What anniversary are you celebrating? 2-year anniversary. Congratulations. That's terrific. And also 2-year anniversary for you? No? How many? 39 years. Congratulations. Such a young man. You were married at 15. I can see that. And how many years have you been married? 55 years. You were 10. Join hands if you can there. Oh God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessing upon these your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their homes may continue to be a haven of blessing and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Happy anniversary. Happy anniversary. Fantastic. You might, if you want to stay here for a second, that'll be, stay here, hang out just a second here. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation, in whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Travel safely. If you would like to stay, you can. Please move right over here. Just move over just a little bit. I'd like for you to stay. If you would just move over just a little bit. I would like to bring Wendell and Camille up here for just a second. Stand up here just a little bit. Stand up here. Both of you. Come, both of you. And if you two will move right there. Wendell is in the United States Navy. And Wendell is being deployed here in how many days?
7 days.
Wendell is being deployed overseas and will be gone from us for 11 months. So we would like to offer prayers for Wendell and for Camille. And what I would like to do would be to invite any veterans to come forward if you would like to help, because we would like to lay hands on both of them. And then I would also like to invite parishioners to come forward and lay hands on both of them. We don't have this very often in this parish, and I've got to tell you, this is hard. We've had a lot of talks about this. There is a part of this, I find this incredibly generous on your part, for both of you, but I also find this very difficult, and it's hard to give you up and have you out of this community. So we have our veterans coming up. Please come forward. Don't hesitate. Just come forward. If you want, I'll tell you what. If you'll stand right down here. Stand right. There you go. Both of you. There you go. Stretch out your arms longer. You can touch the person behind you, and it all works. Trust me, it all works. It all works. So I'm going to invite, please, I'm going to wait till people come on up. If you would like to pray from your pew, that is fine, with an outstretched hand, that is great. There are a lot of people up here praying for you. Praying for you both. Let us pray. Wendell, as you leave the fold of this community and travel overseas to protect the liberties we enjoy here in our lives and safeguard our way of life, may you go forward, secure in the knowledge that you are in our prayers, both you and Camille, and that both you and Camille are held in God's loving arms. May your sacrifice be one of compassion and free of danger. All this we ask in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. We will pledge to take care of Camille while Wendell is away from us. I would like to give you this prayer for the armed services, Episcopal prayer book for the armed services. It's small, and I hope it just packs away in a small place. And you don't have a lot of room to pack things, so I hope it doesn't take up too much space. But please go with our blessing. Go in peace. We love you dearly, and we look forward to seeing you back as quickly as possible. Godspeed, my friend. Peace. Hold on one second.
I made space in my sea bag, so this is going to fit just right. I got space just enough for it. But most importantly, I want to say thank you for sharing the liturgy of the word and the Eucharist with me on a weekly basis. And I want to say that I'm inspired by the kids that are here. And it's a great place to be to offer your service. And I see that you served in a very way, and I want to say it's an honorable thing to do. All the youth group that contribute to the community, an extension, humanity is much better because you made a positive decision. I want to say thank you. And thanks to everybody for their prayers. The power of prayer is always welcome for each and every one of us. And I'll be praying for you guys. And I'll miss you. Hoorah.
We will see you soon. We are also entering our stewardship season. So, Stephanie, I asked Stephanie Lee Harris if she would talk to us about stewardship. See, I set it right up. To follow that would be great. Talk to us about Consecration Sunday. Come to the pulpit and speak with us and talk to us about our stewardship and our faith. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. As Father said, he'd like me to remind you of an important upcoming event, which is Consecration Sunday. What Sunday? Okay. What is it? In simple terms, it's the day of ingathering of our financial contributions, which help us to grow spiritually in our relationship with God by supporting the ministries of our church. It is also a day of celebration when we all share a meal to celebrate the love of God and rejoice in our giving. Consecration Sunday will be November 19th and 20th, with a celebration meal following each worship service. It is not a potluck meal, but a catered meal for which you must make a reservation if you plan to attend. While preparing for the Sunday, please pray prayerfully, ponder the following questions. See who's listening. Do you want to help our church? Do you want to help our church?
Yes.
Okay. Do you see giving as a duty or a joy? Thank you. Do you feel that giving adds meaning to your life?
Yes.
All right, you don't have to answer the rest. Do you feel you diminish your relationship with God if you don't give? Do you feel God's judgment if you don't give? If you give out of habit, social, or peer pressure, or out of joy and thanks for your blessing. I ask you to look at stewardship from a biblical perspective and not from a budget balancing perspective. Sorry, Steve. The Bible teaches that people who take seriously the stewardship of all that God gives them have the following characteristics. They give through the church. This is from Malachi. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house, and test me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows. They give liberally. This is from Luke. Give, and it will be given to you. They will pour into your lap a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. For by your standard of measure, it will be measured by you in return. And the last, they give sacrificially, which is from Corinthians. For I testify that according to their ability and beyond their ability, they gave of their own accord. They give cheerfully. Each one must do just as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And they give regularly, from Corinthians. On the first day of every week, each one of you is to put aside and save, as he may prosper, so that no collections be made when I come. It is clear that there is nowhere in biblical instruction for giving to a church budget. However, we do find abundant texts that urge people to give to God. So we hope in the next few weeks, we all find it in our hearts to give to our church and support our different ministries, which as you look around are many. The choir, the Sunday school, many others, the altar guild. And I hope you just all find it in your hearts. And thank you for letting me speak today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
What we wear and why we wear it are conditioned by culture and custom. In most parishes, folks don't dress up as they did a generation ago, men in coats and ties and women all in hats. Clergy attire has changed as well. So far as we can tell, the clergy and the people dressed the same in the early days of the church. The Jewish priests wore elaborate vestments in the temple, but the early Christians, with no tradition to guide them, seemed to have dressed like everyone else. As time went on, the styles changed, and most Christians changed with the fashions, except the clergy. Somehow it seemed wrong for the clergy to be too trendy, so they continued to dress in the old-fashioned style of their predecessors. Eventually, the clerical style of dress became so completely out of date that their special vestments became associated only with the church. But these unique vestments were simply the normal street dress of the late Roman Empire. What was practical became traditional. What was the street dress of the Roman Empire? A more formally dressed citizen would probably have worn a long white robe called an alb. On cooler days, he would add a poncho-like heavier piece of fabric called a chasuble, the Latin word for a little house. Father Mark, if you will. Episcopal clergy often begin vesting by putting on a long white alb, and then belting it with a cord called a cincture. I wear a cord, Deacon Lorna wears a cord. Father Mark, because he is a canon, wears a purple cincture, a fabric cincture, along with bishops, deans, archdeacons. It's like the military. You get more stripes, you wear something different. The corded cincture is also sometimes referred to as a girdle. I don't do that because as a young person, I wore one. Next, they drape a long band of cloth around the neck. This is the scarf that the Romans called a stola, and we call a stole. Over the centuries, the church developed explanations for these vestments that had nothing to do with their real origins, but instead gave mystical meanings. The chasuble, for example, was said to express the virtue of love and charity that covers everything else. The stole symbolized the yoke, joining the wearer to Christ in a shared ministry. These mystical meanings were made up way long after the fact. The vestments are not intended to draw attention to the individuals wearing them or to emphasize personal idiosyncrasies. Church vestments are intended to conceal individual differences and identify clergy by their office.
Thank you.
font, the pulpit, the altar, or the holy table are the required pieces of furniture for our worship. The pews, the altar rails, the kneelers are icing on the cake. Chairs, rather than pews, trust me, make a space better for worship. Okay, just take it, but take this also. There have probably never been more controversies in a church than when churches tried to take out the pews and put in chairs. Other than trying to fiddle with the creed, more blood spilt, chairs versus pews. But in most Orthodox churches, they don't have pews because all people stand in the presence of the risen Christ. Our lives in Christ begin at the font. There we are washed. We are nourished with the word of life and the bread of life from the pulpit and the altar, respectively. There are various tables called credence tables that are employed to hold the vessels used in worship. The ombre, or the tabernacle, is where the consecrated elements are reverently stored so that there is sufficient sacrament in case of an emergency or for ministry to the homebound or the hospitalized. The candle burns before the tabernacle, alerting all who enter the church that the sacrament is reserved, that they are in the presence of the real presence of Christ. Not all Episcopal churches reserve the sacrament. So you go in the church, you don't see a red candle burning. And always to me, it feels like there's something missing. There are other appointments in the church. At baptisms, funerals, and during the great 50 days of Easter, the Paschal candle burns. There are stations of the cross around the aisles. The devotion of Stations of the Cross is another opportunity to have a procession. At the back, there is a candle stand, a candle rack, where you can light a candle and then pray for umpteen different people and things going on in your lives. And you also pray for all the intentions that are represented by the candles already lighted. We do not have a bell tower, but a tolling bell calls attention when there's been a death in the community or the war has ended. Recently, there was a call in Episcopal churches with bells about a week and a half ago to toll the bell on a particular day at noon to commemorate the deaths of all the refugees. St. Nicholas and Pompano Beach tolled their bell. A particular pattern of bells designates the prayer, the Angelus, which commemorates the angel Gabriel coming to Mary and telling great news, recalls the incarnation. And here in this parish, we use bells to draw us to pray or to draw our attention to important parts of the Eucharist. So you'll see different materials, different bits of hardware and software around the church that have been identified. And so I invite you after the service, if you're a parent or a godparent, to take your child around and to look and to identify the various things that we have put up signs for.
At this time, I would like to invite all the young people who would like to come forward and celebrate with me up here at the altar, along with your parents if you would like, and any adults who would like to come up also. Perfect. In this room? Yeah, perfect, perfect. Come on up. And right there. Come right on this side. Maybe you'll get that other stool and then stand behind her. I'm going to let you stand right here. This is an important spot here. Stand behind her. We ready? The bread and the wine, the body and blood of Christ. Help me with this. The Great Thanksgiving continues with Eucharistic Prayer A and can be found on page 361 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Concentrate right here. We're going to keep our eyes right here. Can we put our arms out like this? Perfect. Put them up. There we go. We'll celebrate together. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Would our lay Christian visitor please come forward?
Visit those who are ill and homebound.
In the name of this congregation, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body, because we all share one bread, one cup.
In one way or another, the appointments, the hardware, the fabrics, the incense, the hymns, the prayers, the wine, water, and oil, the liturgical year are all intended to draw us into the mystery of God's love and the fellowship of the Holy Trinity. Likewise, they are what we have to offer in worship. As we have gathered here this morning, have you entered into worship with your whole body? Which aspect of the worship was more meaningful for you today? What surprised you about our worship? And what will draw you back to be with us all and with the risen Christ next week?
May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.